Morning. You were on time and I was a minute late. Forgiveness is the hallmark of this congregation. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome to those of you who are seated here with us in the sanctuary of Peachtree Christian Church this Sunday morning, April 14, 2024. And to those of you watching us online or recorded version, you too are very welcome. We are a congregation that strives for reconciliation, cultivation, and care. And we invite each one of you to be part of this community. If you are interested in becoming a member, we're going to have a session on April 28th called Starting Point, 10 o'clock Sunday morning. Look for you to come, hear more about the church. And if you are ready to become a member of this congregation, we invite you to come forward at the end of this service during the last song and make your declaration of faith. We have someone in the pew hold up the little bitty white piece of paper. It's about that big. There we go. Thank you. Thank you, Adam. Yes, this is Eucharistic Communities. I hope all of the pews have this little one. The piece of paper is not big, but the message is enormous. And we want every one of you to participate. This is to create Eucharistic communities, to explore and emphasize the social meaning of the Eucharist and what it means to the church and to you personally. You can create a new group if you're already in a group and you want to institute this practice in it, or you just want more information, let us know. Sign that little piece of paper, put your email legibly, please, and we will get back in touch with you. If you're watching online, you can email the church. You can email any one of the ministers, and we'll help you get this sorted out. I know that many of you are very devoted and very accomplished students of the Bible. I just saw some of our family come in from Switzerland. Welcome back! Our members who have moved away and are here visiting, thank you. If someone said to you, where are the creation stories in the Bible? I bet most of you would say, oh, Genesis 1. Well, guess what? There's a lot of them. And some of them, many of them, are in the New Testament. Yes. Wednesday night class taught by Dr. Saunders is a brilliant class. It's not too late. We've had one session. You can watch the video of it and get all caught up. But I invite you to register for that and participate. Wednesday night, four more Wednesday nights to go. You can sign up on peachtree.org or just call the church. We'll help you get it sorted out. We want you to participate. Oh, my. Now, please, participate in this way. Fill out your attendance, mark your attendance, in the welcome pads that are in every pew. Share it with everyone in your pew. And those of you online, it's just a little button that you push. It's really simple. We're delighted you're here. Now, let's enter into worship. God bless each and every one of you. Thank you. Please open your order of worship to your call to worship. We will say this together and you will respond with the bold text. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, who lives and reigns with you Amen. Please stand. Our opening hymn is number 220, O Sons and Daughters. Sing your praise. We will do stanzas 1-4 together.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we ask for your presence with us this morning. As we gather together in this place and online, we gather together to worship you, to praise you, and to give thanks for all you are and all you have done. As we respond to the empty tomb, we rejoice and continue to long for your return. We also lift up prayers in response to the Iranian airstrike in Israel. And we pray that you protect those who are innocent of war in Gaza and Israel and bring an end to this conflict quickly and not in an escalation. Come, Lord, quickly. Amen. And now, if you will please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated.
And now our sanctuary choir and handbells are going to surround you. Not to annoy you or confuse you, but we have a lovely piece, and it calls for spatial separation, and I think you will enjoy it. So sit back, fasten your seatbelt, and enjoy this exciting arrangement of Alleluia.
beautiful arrangement. That was lovely. Please turn in your order of worship to our confession and assurance. I'll give you a moment to get there, and we will speak these words aloud together because it is important in our faith to confess, and it is a wonderful blessing that we receive the assurance that when we confess our sins and turn away and ask God for forgiveness, that He gives that to us. So please join me in our confession and assurance. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Having received peace with our Creator, we ask that you please stand and extend the peace of Christ to those around you.
Thank you for greeting each other so warmly. And to those of you watching online, peace be with you too. We love you, and we hope you can be with us in person as often as possible. There's a children's song that says, if you're happy and you know it, clap your hands.
Oh, okay, clap your hands.
Well, this is the time where we collect our offerings, the tithes and the gifts and spontaneous offerings. And I think it's appropriate to say, if you are blessed, extend the blessing back to others through your giving. In a few moments, our deacons are going to pass praise here in the sanctuary. I know many of you give online or by text, or you mail in checks once a month. The method of giving isn't important, but the meaning behind it is. And we thank you for always being a generous and caring church. When these trays come to you, not only may you put your offering in the tray, you may put your Eucharistic community inquiry card in the tray and a prayer request. We honestly pray for every card that comes to us with something that's on your heart. God bless you each and every one.
Thank you.
stand for the singing of the doxology.
Loving and generous Father, we love you so much. Let each of these gifts reflect that and bless the giver of each item in this tray. Father, we love you, we thank you, and we bless your name now and always in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. Amen. And for the reading of Scripture.
Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified, and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and blood, and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed him his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand Scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of the Lord.
Please be seated. My friends, it is a delight to be with you on this very fine championship Sunday. That's right, the Masters in full swing. I wore a green jacket today because I am a winner. You'll get to see that later. I've decided to rename the corner of Peace Street and Spring as Amen Corner. Because Lord knows you're going to shout out Amen a lot today, aren't you? All right. I didn't want to say anything about this, but someone after the 9 o'clock said, "You know, you share honestly with your people." And I want you to know that if most of you all know I went through a transplant, or are probably bored of me talking about it, but the person wanted me to share, and I think it's important to note that once you're a transplant patient, it's not like things are just perfect, right? You're always a transplant patient. There's stuff that you're up and down with. I'm having a hard go of it today, I think a medication thing, but I've been having a hard month. And so I want to just make you aware of that before we pray, because I covet your prayers, but also I want to acknowledge the fact that if you're here today, you're probably going through something too. It may be physical, it may be emotional. I just know one truth. Everyone who comes and sits in a church on a Sunday is in some way in transition from one thing to another. And so I appreciate the fact that you took time to pause, to be together, to share together, to hear the words of the Lord together. And now, because of that, it's important for us, in my opinion, to have a sacred pause where we just let ourselves settle, let our minds and spirits catch up to our bodies, and ask this whole and sincere heart for the Holy Spirit to speak to us. So if you wouldn't mind, I want you to close your eyes and just do some breathing. But if you're like me, the physicality of worship is important too. I invite you to put your hands out just like this in a receiving posture, where we are asking the Spirit to speak to us. Hold your hands like this, close your eyes, and just take a few cleansing breaths.
whenever you're ready, take in a very deep and very cleansing breath. And try to empty all the air from your lungs, letting everything go, every tension go. The next breath in is the breath of God. Breathe in the breath of God. Spirit, we are here today in the name of Jesus Christ. And we ask you to come upon us today, wherever my voice may be heard, that your heart for us would be heard. The beauty that you have made for us would be seen. The grace would be felt and experienced. That your love would transform us. God, whether anyone else knows it or not, you and I know that without you, I can do nothing. So we ask that these words be true. No matter how much I've prayed over them or studied them or thought, we pray that your Spirit pierces each of our hearts with something transformative that we may be more like you. God, we ask that you be here today and let us live differently. It is in the matchless name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that I pray, and God's people together today.
Amen.
I'm going to move my mic down a little bit there. Hopefully that helps. When I was in middle school, I, like many middle school boys, tried to find ways to spend time with girls that I liked. But in middle school, you really can't go dating like you can at other periods of time in life. I didn't have a license, for instance. And so the era that I grew up in, when you were in middle school, you often asked your mom and dad to take you to the mall to drop you off to hang out with some other people at the mall, and maybe you would spend time together. I know I'm dating myself, but that means I'm a mall rat. One particular day, I asked to meet a gal. She brought a friend. We met at the mall, and we walked around like middle school kids do at malls, back when they used to go to the malls. We didn't have any money, so we didn't buy anything. We just walked aimlessly, trying, I suppose, to impress one another. We gathered in one of those little settee areas of the mall in the middle there. You know those couches? I don't even know the last time I was in a mall. Do they still have them? I sat in one of those with these two gals, and I remember trying to come up with interesting things to tell them to impress them. There was a lull in the conversation, and so I thought, I know what to tell them. I'll tell them what my mom told me last week. My mom told me of a news story that seemed interesting to me. There was a man in my hometown who took a walk near a railroad track, and unbeknownst to him, he had a condition that would make him have seizures. And he had one for the very first time when he fell on the railroad track. And the train came by. Now, what's really remarkable is that his left arm was severed completely from his body and cleanly, whereas his left hand was mangled. His right arm was severed and it was mangled, but the right hand was severed cleanly and it wasn't mangled. And so the story in the newspaper said that he had a prosthetic right arm, but they were able to take his left arm and reattach it, but they reattached his right hand to his left arm. Incredible story. So I decided to tell these two girls at the mall all about it, thinking that would impress them. There was a woman sitting across from us who had one of those looks of smugness on her face and a small smile. And the girls, when I told them the story, said, "No way, that's not true, you're making that up." The woman across from us said, "Oh, no, he's not. In fact, if you wait 5 minutes, you'll see him come down the way here. He's my husband." I don't know how you receive information, but middle school Jared thought he was in trouble. I just didn't say a word. My mouth was kind of agape. I couldn't believe it. I know I told him the story. I knew I could trust my mom, but here I was in the mall, and I now couldn't believe it all of a sudden. Sure enough, he came walking down the hallway of the mall. Can you call them hallways? I don't know. Came walking down the way. He had the prosthetic arm. He had his left arm attached with his right hand on. And he saw his wife, and she smiled, and she winked at her husband. I think that he knew I had been talking about it or something. And then he said, "Honey, you ready to go?" And she stood up and said, "Yes, I am." And they held hands, and I noticed that he held up his hand, and they walked down the mall. Now, the two girls I was with started giggling. I suppose sometimes that might be the response when you don't know what to say or how to receive something. He's black. I didn't say a word because I was afraid I was going to get into some more trouble. I just thought, I can't believe what I'm seeing. You ever had an experience that was just like that? You thought you could believe it until you saw it, and then you weren't sure anymore. Well, that's the disciples in the passage that we're reading. In fact, we catch them right in the midst of a resurrection moment with Jesus Christ. The story preceding this one is where they encounter Jesus on the road, and they don't know it's him until he breaks bread with them. And the way he does it, they have an awareness that he is Jesus. It's actually secured here in this image behind this, on the baptistry wall, this painting. It is a painting of that moment where they recognize Jesus because of how he eats them. And then he disappears like that. And so our passage tells us, it begins with, and they were talking about this, kind of like some young people in a mall. They were just talking about something extraordinary. And then Jesus shows back up, and they're afraid. Why do you suppose that they were so afraid? Well, they had just gone through a lot on Good Friday and Holy Saturday. Their teacher was killed by the hands of the state. He was buried, and he was dead. Their hopes had been dashed. Now, we've come through Easter, and I told you on Easter Sunday, and I want to remind you again, that Christianity is not reducible to a set of beliefs, but it's rather the response that we make to the empty tomb. Christianity is not reducible to a set of dogmas or beliefs. It's actually the response that we make to the empty tomb. What difference does it make to follow Jesus is what we're asking about when we see the empty tomb. And here they're still sorting it all out. And they're afraid. They're astonished. They can't explain what they're seeing when they see Jesus in their midst. Why? Did they not listen to what he said was going to happen to him? Well, allow me to offer not a moral answer or a supernatural answer. Let me give you the most naturalistic answer I can get to you for why the disciples might have been afraid or in disbelief or just simply astonished at Jesus in the presence before them that day. It's because they are experiencing that which they never thought imaginable. It doesn't even matter if Jesus said, "Guys, I'm going to die, and 3 days later I'll be raised." As clear as can be stated, it doesn't even matter. It's not the normal ordering of the world to experience resurrection from the grave. That doesn't just happen. And so I think when things don't happen the way we expect, it can send our brain and our thinking into all kinds of unique places, including fear, astonishment, and disbelief, even though we see it with our own eyes. My grandmother, my mom's side of the family is the least sporting family I've ever met in my life. They didn't know anything about sports, save for bare-knuckle boxing at the bar. And I think my uncle won some award for his shooting. After he got drunk one night, he went out and shot up a lot of streetlights. His award was a couple years in prison. This is the runners and bootleggers side of the family. We all got those wings, don't we? They didn't know anything about sports. They weren't sporting types. My grandmother, sweet, sweet woman, she knew more about Patsy Cline, Loretta Lynn, and Dolly Parton. She loved Jesus. She loved chicken and noodles. She loved her family. She didn't know anything about sports until she met my dad, and she fell in love with my dad. Now, my dad used to know about him. He's a Christian, so therefore he's a St. Louis Cardinal fan. That's a joke. I mean, he is a Cardinal fan and he is a Christian, but that's just a joke, right? So my dad is a diehard Cardinal fan, raised us to be diehard Cardinal fans. And for whatever reason, my grandmother loved him so much that she just one day decided, I'm going to be a diehard Cardinal fan. She bought everything Cardinals that she could find at Love Unlimited, and all kinds of places where she could find bargains and deals, because that's the kind of woman she was. But every night when the St. Louis Cardinals played and they won, she would race to the phone to call my dad and mom to say the immortal words of Jack Buck, "That's the winner." And my mom said, "Mom, who are you and what have you done with my mother?" She became transfixed on baseball. You see, it wasn't the normal order of things in my mom's world to see her mom behave like that, and it made her go, "Huh?" So even if the disciples had good teaching, that they followed about what Jesus said he was going to do, I still submit to you, it's quite natural that when you see a guy who had been murdered the way he was and then buried, to see him able-bodied up and around and maybe appearing and disappearing at a whim, you might still say, huh? And so they suppose he's a ghost, which I just delight in. Because I now want to ask the question, what did the first century people conceive of when they thought of the word ghost? That's an interesting study we could take upon another time. Jesus reasons aloud with them, I'm not a ghost. Look, I'm flesh and blood. Look at the holes in my hands. Look at the wounds on me. I'm not a ghost. They still don't believe. And that's not quite enough to get them to believe. And so Jesus pauses and thinks for a moment. And like a college kid come home to his childhood home, he sticks his head in the fridge and says, you got anything to eat? That's what I love about Jesus. He gets real practical with it. He says, do you have anything to eat? And they offer some broiled fish. Now, intuitively, I think you might be grasping. There's something about food. There's something about a stomach that can bring the senses into clarity. There's something unique about food that teaches us things. Eating is an incredibly important thing, and eating with people is an incredibly profound thing. Today, we've made eating more utilitarian. You can drive down the road, you can get the 99-cent heart attack, and you can get French fries stuck in weird places in your car. That's not what I'm talking about. I know we do work meetings. We still eat lunch with business. They're transactional a lot in our day and time. And sadly so. I've had some lovely meals back when I used to work for a political party. The people there wanted my money. They didn't care who I was. Eating was transactional. But I have to submit to you that in the ancient world, in the world that we're describing right here, eating was never transactional in that way. In fact, it was profoundly covenantal. You didn't just eat with anybody. Eating was a sign, a symbol of profound friendship and commitment, a lifelong commitment, for instance, to one another. You didn't just eat with people. To eat with people was importantly profound in your commitment to them. And Jesus always eats with his friends. He has a piece of food and he begins to share. Something about eating. I was once at an academic theology, philosophy, and science conference at the University of Oxford. I gave a paper there. Don't think too highly of me. I was a student giving a student paper there. People weren't coming to hear me. See, some of the big name speakers were very famous philosophers and theologians. And then we also had Marilynne Robinson, the Pulitzer Prize-winning novelist. And we had two Nobel Prize-winning scientists there, because the conference was about life, the meaning of life. What is biological life? What is all these questions about life? And I found myself, by invitation of a professor, sitting at a pub with Marilynne Robinson, who I love her novels and her writings, she's brilliant, and these two Nobel Prize-winning scientists, and a countless list of theologians and philosophers that I've been reading and have their books on my shelves. And I found myself feeling that imposter syndrome, like one of these people doesn't quite belong. And it was me. And they were discussing things and ordering bottles of wine and fish and chips, and I wasn't saying much, and someone started saying, why don't you say more? Why don't you say something? But I didn't really feel as though I belonged. But you know, when people share a bottle of wine and maybe even say, have a look, try of my fish, something happens. The walls come down, the bridges get built. The next thing you know, I found myself saying something. I think it was something like this. When we're talking about scientific materialism, I said, well, I don't know. I suppose that materialism of that sort does more to describe the way we behavior and the way we imagine the world than describe the realities of it. And I remember one of those scientists saying, oh, good point, good point. Okay, what I just told you is not that profound. But all of a sudden, I feel good. I feel included. I feel welcome. The next thing you know, they said, Jared, would you like some of the H.P. Brown sauce? It's good on your fish. We do it over here in Britain. Next thing you know, I'm just a part of the gang. And it's not about titles. And it's not about the knowledge and IQ level you have. It's just a bunch of people who are concerned about things sitting around the table, sharing from their hearts and their minds, and sharing the joy of the moment. There is something profound about eating with each other. Now, friends, I have told you that Christianity is nothing, it's not a response to the empty tomb. But let me suggest something further. I'm going to borrow it from the patristic scholar John Baer. Let me explain what that means. John Baer is a theologian. He's brilliant. Patristics means he focuses on the first few centuries of the church. He knows what the ancient church did really, really, really well. He's very brilliant about it. He says that in this move, when Jesus asks for something to eat, and he sits with him, and he begins to open the scriptures, that this is the beginning of theology. Theology might scare you. It might sound like a $10 word, but let's think about what a fellow by the name of Anselm said about it. He said in Latin, fides corans intellectum, which means theology, it's faith, seeking, understanding. A faith, a response to the empty tomb, now seeking to understand it. Some people just like to break down the word theology. Theos, God, logos, study of, or communication. Some people just say theology means God talk. However we think about God and think about the issues of Jesus and think about the issues of the church. And then some of you might be uncomfortable still and say, I don't need theology, Pastor. All I want is Bible study. All I need is the Bible. Let me tell you, by saying that alone, you've already said your theological point of view. You can't get away from a faith that seeks understanding. You can't get away from talking about God. You can't get away from bringing your experience, your reason, your background, your world, the scriptures, and Jesus. You can't get away from thinking of these things together, and if you've ever thought of it once, you've thought theologically. Now, here's what's intriguing to me. Jesus was trying to help them understand the reality of his presence with the fifth in that room. And so it says that he eats with them, and he says he opens the scriptures to explain who he is to them in light of the scriptures. Now, if I were to throw you out here on the corner of Amen Corner, Peachtree and Spring, and say, talk to a random stranger and open the Bible and tell them about Jesus, where would you go? To a gospel? Maybe you would go to St. Paul because he's got this beautiful summary. Or maybe some of you are just wild. I want to go to the book of Revelation. Let me suggest to you that all of the New Testament, none of it was even written in this moment. So when Jesus says, open the scriptures, what is he saying? He opens what we often refer to as the Old Testament, or the First Testament. Or some people say the Hebrew Scriptures. It tells us, in particular, in this passage that Jesus looks at the Psalms, these songs of worship and praise, and there he begins to show them how it's written all about him. What's fascinating about this is it tells them that thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed and then to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. Where's that written in the Old Testament? Might I suggest to you that Jesus is doing theology. He is saying there's something more about the scriptures that you grew up with than you realize. Jesus is actually making a profound point about his own identity and how the scriptures work. The ancient church fathers would say that Jesus Christ is the key to the scriptures. In fact, there's a huge change in thinking about the Bible when you're in the ancient world. No longer is it just a bunch of history, maybe with some prophecy about Jesus, pointing to Jesus, and then later when we have the New Testament, it points back to Jesus. No longer is it just that. It's that Jesus unlocks the meaning to all of it. To the Song of Solomon, to the conquest of Canaan, to Jonah and the whale, to Job, to the difficult parts of the Old Testament that we probably, if we're admitting it openly, we don't know how to handle them or preach for them or study them or read them to our children because maybe they're difficult. Jesus, who sits down with his disciples, he goes from resurrection to a table. And there at the convivial table where they have life together and food together, he begins to open the scriptures and they begin to do the work of theology. This is what we believe. Now, I know that this might sound challenging, but let me suggest to you that it's so challenging that people oftentimes just ignore it in the modern church. There's a famous pastor who wrote a book on this, preached sermons on it, and did interviews where he basically said that the contemporary church needs to unhinge from the Old Testament. We don't really need that anymore. We just need to hold on to the New Testament. The problem with that is that Jesus won't do it. St. Paul won't do it. The problem with that is you don't understand Jesus without it. The problem with that is a form of heresy. That means wrong teaching. And the ancient church rejected it time and time again. It said, if you don't understand the Old Testament, you're reading it wrong. I know it's tough because we have a certain method that we read the Bible through. Like, we may have been taught it, or maybe we just picked it up. But we all have these methods that we study Scripture, and the truth of them are, is none of them are very traditional. They're all post-Enlightenment and modern, which means this, and I'll be blunt with you. It means that the way that even in the evangelical world, the way we talk about the Bible leaves very little room for the Holy Spirit. Says, no, Jesus is there in places that you can't readily see, because if the Spirit inspired the Scriptures, and I do believe the Holy Spirit inspired the Holy Scriptures, amen? Is amen in the corner, amen? The Holy Spirit inspires these Scriptures, it means it's probably more than meets the eye. Wow. Tough stuff. I've even heard it said in our own congregation, people say, well, why are we reading that? Aren't we a New Testament church? Let me suggest to you, that's not what that means. To be a New Testament church, as our tradition means, that we look to the New Testament to find the root of how we worship and what we do as a church. For in the New Testament, when they met together daily, Acts 2, they met in each other's homes having Eucharist, devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching based on what? What we call the Old Testament. The fellowship and the breaking of bread and prayers, and they had all things in common. That is what it means to be a New Testament church. It isn't to do away with the Old, it's to find Jesus alive there. It's to find how Jesus is making all things knowable. It's how Jesus is shedding a new light of revelation on all things. You see, we have to interpret the world through the lens of Christ. Christianity is a response to the empty tomb. To be the church is to be a community that theologizes, which means we gather around the table, and we sit down with each other, and we eat. And we talk about how we understand Jesus today in light of my experience, in light of the text, in light of the world. By the way, that still means that the church isn't just a place where we have a list of beliefs, a list of ideas that are in, a list of ideas that are out, and where we can easily exclude people or include people as we wish. And the church is messier than that. The church is anchored by a table. But Christ is the host who brings us food. So sit down and let's talk together about what it means. What's the difference of following Jesus today? What does it mean to follow me, says Jesus, at the table? What does it mean to sit down and reread the old in light of Jesus and look to the new and look to the way Jesus is moving in the world even to this moment? My friend, is the church just a set of beliefs? Today it's more like a club. Has a set of beliefs. I'm not saying it doesn't, but it's all it is. It's just a club. Forget not that also the church is a set of practices. And maybe when we have a hard time finding unity, we ought to think more about our practices than all of the beliefs. Because if we think about the practices, the one thing that we're drawn to more than anything else is the altar box. It's a table-centric faith. Where we gather and say we have this community of care where everyone has a space at this one table, and by goodness, we're going to sit and we're going to talk about what it means to follow Jesus today. That's how we respond to the empty tomb today. We get together and we do a little theology. Theology that way is better than going to a conference to do theology, trust me. You know what happens at theology conferences? Everyone presents papers and no one else goes to them. They all sit out in a coffee shop. They connect with friends and they have coffee. And they have cookies. And they go to the bar and have food. So it's a funny thing that we have theology conferences and people are supposed to present these erudite works and no one goes to them. They just sit out and spend time with each other instead. It's interesting because that is really the call of theology, to gather together around a table and see how Jesus is growing in your world and growing you up for the world. This is a better way of doing theology than writing books and footnotes against each other, because it's life-giving. And I think it's a staple and hallmark of this church, and I hope that it will bless you this week as we think about gathering, not just in faith, but gathering to sit and be with each other and see how Jesus is making your whole life new again, and how he's shedding light, sharing the light in all dark places. God bless you.
Thank you, Dr. Longbone. If you would please stand and take out your red chalice hymnal, we will turn to page number 359 together. Our apostolic affirmation and faith, the Apostles' Creed, and we will speak these words out loud together as a unified body of Christ. Please join me, page 359. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
The hymn that prepares us to receive Holy Communion is hymn number 423, Become to Us the Living Bread. Please remain seated as we sing these three stanzas together.
This morning, we will be taking communion by intinction, which is a little different for this service. And so, with intinction, you will take the bread, and you will dip it in the cup, and then partake of communion. We will start in the back, and we'll have you released by rows, and you'll come forward, receive communion from whoever's on your side, and then please return to your seat by using the 5 hours. And this response, as Jared said, is because our faith is bodily. So our response to the empty tomb every week is this physical, spiritual meal. But we are invited and welcomed as the body of Christ together. And we are called to invite and welcome others into this body together with us as we are welcomed by God. And that is why the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Please pray with me. God, we thank you for your Son, for his life, his death, his resurrection. We thank you for the love and grace you have shown us and the call you have put on us to be the body of Christ in the world. We pray that you fill us with your Spirit this week as we serve and love those you have called us to serve. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gift of God to the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your hearts by faith for Thanksgiving.
our closing hymn, we invite anybody who is interested in becoming a member of PCC, Christian Church, to come forward. We ask if people can say the same things as St. Peter said. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? And if that is your faith, then we welcome you into this fellowship. Quite frankly, what that means is that we are covenanting to walk together as we journey the pilgrim path of Jesus Christ. And if you'd like to walk with us, people, friends, and they're wonderful friends, we invite you forward, and that Reverend Jeremiah would take your confession. For now, Reverend Bell is going to lead us in our final hymn.
Hymn number 220, O Sons and Daughters, Sing Your Praise. This time we will sing stanzas 5 and 6, and I in particular love the 6th stanza, How blessed are those who do not see, yet place their faith and trust in me. They shall have life eternally. Hallelujah. Peace be with you.
I'm joined with Daniel Harvey and Adam Lemieux, and they both are joining as members. Daniel has been a part of our community the last year. He's been with the choir. He's come with the young adults. He's joined Jared's book study before. He's also golfed with Jared, great for Masters Week in reference. But he's been a part of the community, and we're glad to officially welcome him into the family together. So, Daniel, I ask you, to repeat or to answer the question that St. Peter answered. Is Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life and the Son of the living God? And Adam, Adam's been a part of our community for a couple months and has just gotten really connected with us, and we love him so much, and we're so glad to have him become a fifth member of the family. So Adam, you'll also answer the question. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and your Lord and Savior? Wonderful. Amen. Welcome then. Yes, welcome. Yay. All righty. So we're going to, I'm going to take them to the back now to Hail Mary D up back there. And you guys come and say hey and welcome. And I'm going to go. Yeah, I'm going to go. I'm going to go. We're going to go now.
All right. Give a round of applause while you walk, everybody. Thank you so much. So good to welcome new folks. Many of you are aware that I do a book club that meets about once a month on Zoom. Tonight we meet to discuss the Heaven and Earth Grocery Store. And tonight we will be announcing the new book that will read Hidden Potential, the Science of Achieving Greater Things. The book club is all about readings for wisdom. If this interests you, just email me, and I'd love to include you in that. In the order of worship on the backside, there's a couple of announcements that we didn't mention that we want to highlight now. One is that next Sunday, April 21st, in Burns Hall, we have a meal for the congregation, and we invite you to come and bring your friends. And at that meal, there will also be an open house for Anyone Can Camp. We actually are hosting Caleb Albert from Anyone Can Camp this summer to host a few summer camps for children for various activities and things. And if you're curious about that, you can come and meet him. And he's offering, we're offering, how many camps are we doing, Katie?
Oh,
okay, we're offering lots of camps, 3 or 4 camps this summer. So she came up here to help me with that announcement. So you come back for Anyone Camps and lunch next week. Again, our Eucharistic communities that we're talking about our new groups that we want to start, or learning how to make the Eucharist communion part of your existing group. And there's an entire reason that's theological as well as practical for doing this. And so if you're interested, just put the paper in the back of your pew, or just email my office, and we will get back with you on that. For now, let me leave you with these words of benediction. I pray that you do some good theologizing in your life, that you gather around a meal with other brothers and sisters who've been saved by Jesus Christ, and you keep asking the question how Jesus is moving in your life, how Jesus can take you forward from here to touch other people's lives. And I bless you through all that and more. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.